We've talked about how to add numbers using adders in previous videos. In this video, we will talk about how to build memory units to store the computing result made up of one bit. We learned how computers compute from previous videos. By using binary number system, computers only need to know how to add zeros and ones. Human efforts can be eliminated by using electrical voltage as numbers. Feed them through carefully connected transistor switches. The little sandwich structure made of silicon. It can be turned into conduction when applied high voltage. We then made a half adder as the building blocks for computing in computers. To add 1 plus 1, we strike both inputs with high voltages, turning on the second wire. Here's the result, 1-0, binary form of 2. Then we have to think about how to store this result. Because as the high voltage inputs go away, the low voltage will stay the same, since this is the natural state, as it's connected to low voltage end. But this high voltage will also revert to the natural state. So here is an important aspect of building a memory device. It's all about how to store the unnatural state, a high voltage in this case. Before you proceed, please make sure you are comfortable with transistors and the logic gates made from those different transistor connections. You can check previous videos for that. To store this electricity output, the easiest way is to use a capacitor. It can be made of two conductors placed very close to each other, such as aluminum foil, represented by these two bars. When the control is on, we are ready to store data. High voltage is going to pull electrons away from one side, showing high voltage, hence attracting more electrons to the other side, effectively storing the physical charges. This is called dynamic memory, DRAM. It's slow and has leakage problem, but they are inexpensive as you can get from Best Buy. The memory we will talk about is high-speed static RAM, like cache memory used for computing, made of pure transistors without the need to store physical charges. Now let's use the second output bit as an example. Without a physical storing device like capacitors, you can't really make the output stay, but you can replicate it by using it as input to drive another output transistor. But still, when input goes away, the replica goes away. So, to maintain the replica, the secret is to have a backup input through two parallel routes, controlled by two separate switches. The data input and the backup input can both drive the output transistor independently. It's actually the parallel connection, or gate, allowing two ways to drive the output. Let's place the two parts on top of each other. A high input will get bottom route conducting, turning down the output. Now if you feed the output back to the second route, the backup will be turned down. Using output as input drive is called feedback. It might sound strange at first, but most of us are actually experts in using this technique already. Use what happened last time to drive decision next time. That's the essential property of human memory as well. Now even as input goes away, the backup is going to sustain the loop. But what if later on you want to store a low voltage output? We need to be able to erase this high voltage output. To clear it, we need to add a control transistor, connect it to the output transistor. Applying low voltage to it, the output will become low, turning off the feedback. But now when you pass data input, not only you need this control transistor conducting, permitting data to pass, but also you need to keep it conducting in order to maintain the output. So you better leave it conducting naturally. By connecting it to high voltage, then by default, it will always be on. But then, you also need to be able to clear the result. That's why we need an inverter, with a resistor-transistor pair, outputting from below the resistor, so that if you turn it on, it will connect the output to the low voltage end, turning off the control transistor, resetting the result. But if you leave it off, by default, the inverter will output high voltage, because it's connected to the high voltage end, keeping the control transistor conducting, allowing input to pass and stay. This parallel gate is OR gate. Zero gate is AND gate. This is an inverter. It's called set, reset, and OR latch. But there's a problem. When we want to pass low voltage input, typically data will fluctuate a few times before it stabilizes. But because two types of inputs, data input and backup input, share the same route, once a high voltage feedback takes over, low voltage input can no longer flow through. So to write the finalized low input, you will have to clear it first. But you wouldn't know when the data will be ready, so you wouldn't know when to reset, making it a useless memory device. A useful memory piece should have a control hand allowing us to turn it on, going into write mode, so that we can write and overwrite whatever we want. To lock down the data, we can turn the control off. Now it will disconnect the input so that input changes won't affect the output. The output will stay as whatever it was. I hope this video gives you a basic idea about building memories using transistors. In the next video, we will build more practical memory units based on the set, reset, and or latch. And that will help you to gain a more thorough understanding about memory.